No, actually, what it is, it's to announce that the new What Was I Thinking book has just arrived, so I've got a couple of copies if anybody wants to start a study group here. We can do that. We just thank you, Father God, for this day that you've made, and we want to rejoice and be glad in it. We thank you, Father God, that we've got authority to break and bind and cancel your Son, the enemy, over all of us and our loved ones. We thank you, Lord, that we can watch and study your word and be counted worthy to escape all the things that are coming across this world. In the almighty name of Jesus. Amen. So I want to talk to you about faith this morning, staying in faith. We read in 2 Corinthians 1:20, it says, "For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us." So straight away that rebukes all the people out there with dispensational theories that try to steal, rob from Christians things like the benefits of healing in this present dispensation. When you look at the church today and the secular world, we're going to see a big difference. And we're not. And that troubles me. And so I feel like, you know, we've got to keep hammering away with the word of God here, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing, and hearing. In Romans 12:2 it says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, which may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God." So the world is filled with people that are going around offending each other. Has anybody noticed that? I mean, everywhere you look, people are being offended. They're lying, they're cheating, they're being dishonest in their business relationships, and things are falling apart around them, the marriages, the sort of financial troubles. They feel lost, they feel abandoned, they feel rejected, and probably feeling like they must be under some kind of curse. And I'm not just saying no, right? We don't like the word curse, it is in the scriptures. So people become like addicted to alcoholic drinks and certain drugs and things. They go to see psychologists and secular healthcare professionals, and they often end up on medication that deadens the pain. Give me something to deaden the pain. I'm tormented. I need something to deaden the pain. So they go to the secular people for that, professionals, right? Which is to me like going to a mechanic. You know, you go, my lights come on. The oil light's coming on, can you do something about it? The mechanic goes, sure, got a pair of cutters here, we'll just cut the wire and you won't see the light anymore. Right, makes a lot of sense, doesn't it? We'll just dim the pain. So you're driving along in your motor car and at some point you're probably going to experience some mechanical failure because it doesn't have the proper amount of oil. So we need to have faith for whatever it is that's going on in your life. If you need restoration, if you need healing, you need to have faith. And faith is pretty much like a muscle. It grows stronger when you exercise it. It's like going to the church, it's like going to the gym, right? Exercise our faith. It says in Mark 11:22, "And Jesus answering said unto them, Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, be cast in the sea, shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray," it doesn't even say, you know, that I need, or it says whatever you desire. There's no condition there, right? It's open. "What things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them." So even though I've been preaching on this, teaching on this, writing books about scriptural principles to help bring people the place of healing, of restoration, there's really no guarantee that anything's going to happen, because if I can guarantee that, you wouldn't need faith for it, would you? That is why I want to put a sign up front that says salvation guaranteed or your sins cheerfully refunded. See, faith is vital to you to receive healing for anything, because you know, this, it matters to God, if it matters to him, right? James 5:14 tells us where to go. If any sick among you, let him call on the elders of the church, let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall rise him up. And if he committed sins, they shall be forgiven. Well, how are you going to get rid of sins unless you confess them, right? Confess your faults one to another. Pray one for another, and that you may be healed. The effectual fervent prayers of the righteous man availeth much. So in other words, is anybody sick, maybe troubled, you call on the church elders, the spiritual guides, the leaders of the church, and they should pray over you, and anoint you with oil, and then the prayer of faith is going to bring you to that place that you meet with the Lord. This is the heartfelt continual prayer of a righteous man. Has tremendous power. There's so much power in our words, right? Words speak life and death in words. How much more when we get in the presence of God for this? So the Lord created everything, all the universes, all the parallel universes, all of it, right? And after sin enters in, and the fall of the atom, he brings basically death, is the ultimate price for disobedience to the word of God. And we read in 2 Timothy 1:10, but now is made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. So the Lord Jesus wants to save you, he wants to bless you, he wants to heal you, he wants to prosper you. That's the way, God likes it, right? So do you think that the Lord Jesus reacts the way that most people do when he confronts sicknesses and diseases? Do you think the Lord hears any doubt or unbelief that, I wonder if I could heal that blind person? What about that cancer patient or that heart patient or the deaf or the lame person? Do you think he has any doubts that he can fix a marriage or family problems or business problems or fix a nation? Does he have any doubts about that? Is anything too hard or impossible for the Lord? Our holy guidebook to the supernatural clearly tells us all things are possible with God, meaning you've got a part to play in it, right? With God, you're going to do this with faith. In Matthew 19:26, but Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. Hallelujah for that one. So considering that before Jesus, Yeshua, was Jesus, he was called what? The living word. This also means that, you know, when you know the word of God, you know the Lord Jesus. Many people know about Jesus, but what's vitally important is that you know him as Lord of your life, over every aspect of your life. So after Jesus conquered death and he was resurrected, he sent the Holy Spirit to teach us all that we need to know, all that we need to work on, to work through us, to guide us, to direct us, through every conflict that we experience, everything that we ever face, that he's there and his awesomeness, that we can meditate on his truth. So in our holy guidebook to the supernatural, it tells us Jesus magnified his word even above his own name. And there's no name above the name of Jesus, right? So this is significant to us. It tells us in Psalm 138, verse 1, I will praise thee with my whole heart before the gods, little gods there, everything, right? Will I sing praises unto thee? I will worship towards thy holy temple and praise thy name for thy loving kindness, for thy truth, for thou hast magnified thy word above all thy name. So you can call on the name of Jesus. A lot of people doing that, calling on the name of Jesus all day. We're supposed to be like dialing the wrong telephone number. But it's not going to work in any dimension, right, if you're not being a doer of the word. It'd be like, man, I just hope if I just keep dialing random numbers, maybe one of them will connect. I remember back in the 70s, I was involved in the Broadway stuff there, and we were at some party with a bunch of celebrities, and somebody got in that they didn't think they were supposed to be there, and they said, how'd you get here? I said, I got connections. You need to find connections, right? So that's what we need here. So unless you really know the word of God, how are you going to be able to boldly enter into his throne room and state your case, make your request? I've told this before, in my case, where there's a little, they didn't care who I was talking to. And once I was talking to Dr. Charles Riley, we were here in the meeting, I think my son came in and said, can I have some money for the machine? So we're kind of busy right now. Dad, can I have some money for the machine? Yeah, okay, excuse me, Dr. Charles Riley, study Bible guy. I have to tend to my son, you know, right? And God will do that for us as well, won't he, and much more. So how are you able to use these awesome weapons that the Lord has given you, except, you know, by accepting his invitation, join, be part of his prayer warrior army here? So thus, we have the word in us, and now it's not going to work very well for you. So when the devil came to tempt Jesus, right, he took scripture out of context. The Lord Jesus quoted the scripture properly back in context and made the devil leave. I like that arrangement. It says submit to God, resist the devil, he's going to flee. For the devil's more afraid of you as a child of God than you realize. We've got the power to make him go. I think that's an awesome thing. Now, we know the enemy of our soul gives us thoughts that, without knowing the word of God, we might think these are our very own thoughts. And we're also starting to understand from medical research and science that how our hypothalamus gland picks up those thoughts and then our body responds accordingly. So do you think the devil understands this? That he can get you to accept the spirit of fear in your imaginations and set up strongholds that eventually destroy you? So medical research is showing, you know, that spirit of fear which God did not give you, that stress, that anxiety you're dealing with is behind thousands of documented sicknesses and diseases and business troubles and marriage troubles and all kinds of relationships. Now, again, you know, God is in control, but only you can control your thought life. So we must be very careful, stay in the Word of God so the Word of God stays in you. And then you receive thoughts from the Word of God, and then your hypothalamus picks them up and your body responds with blessings, releases all the good chemicals, the healing molecules. Again, you know, we're back to 2 Corinthians 10:5, casting down imaginations. And every high thing, it's not just low things, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. So you've got to be careful what you think about. Because your thoughts do what? They turn into words, and then the words have great power. Remember, life and death is in the power of the tongue. And they cause you to act upon the things that you actually say. And then your actions turn into, you know, habits, and habits establish your character. So in the Holy Scriptures, it illustrates this principle of sowing and reaping. That means you're going to, you know, shaping your destiny by what you think. So if you go out this spring here and you plant corn, don't expect tomatoes to grow up, right? It doesn't work that way. So what you sow is what you're going to reap here. Now, again, you know, your faith has healed you. He tells us over and over again. In Matthew 9, verse 27, it says, when Jesus departed thence, two blind men followed him, crying, saying, Thou Son of David, have mercy on us. And when he came into the house, the blind man came to him, and Jesus said unto them, believe ye that I'd be able to do this? And he said, yeah, Lord. Then he touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith be it unto you. And in other words, these two blind men, they heard about the wondrous works of Jesus. Somehow they've heard about the miracles, and they hear that Jesus is coming through their town. And they start crying out, Son of David, have mercy on us. And he doesn't stop. How come he did the other times he stopped? How come he didn't turn around on the ground and go, wait, hold on, a couple of blind guys are going to go heal him, right? He doesn't do that. He keeps going, and he waits for them in the house till he's going to go have a church meeting in. And then they show up. I think possibly this was because he wanted them to put their faith into action. So just these two blind guys following each other, trying to locate Jesus. They didn't have the GPS at the time, really, you know. Okay, take a left here, and Jesus will be on your right. They have the Holy Spirit guiding them, perhaps, but they show up. And I think possibly because he needed them to put faith in action, not to be lukewarm about it, you know, be hot or cold, right? so he can spew them out of his mouth. So Jesus carries on. He's starting a church meeting. They reach the house where he's equipped. They went in, and as soon as the man comes to him, he says, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" Yeah, put your faith into action here. And they said, "Yeah, Lord." And he touches their eyes according to your faith, according to your trust, according to your reliance on the power invested in you by the power of God. Be it done unto you. Well, our friend Donna Taylor was here this week recording some music with me, and we ended up doing a show on spiritual encounters. She testified how she had prayed in a meeting and a blind person started screaming, "I can see." Hallelujah. In Matthew 9:20 it says, "And behold, a woman which was diseased with an issue of blood 12 years came behind him, touched the hem of his garment, for she said within herself, 'But if I may touch his garment, I will shall be whole.' And Jesus turned him about, and when he saw her, he said, 'Daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith has made thee whole.'" The woman was made whole that hour. That was faith in action, right? In those times, she was unclean. She'd go to every doctor in Israel. She said, "Well, she's all the experts of the day. I don't know what they were prescribing medicine, but she's been everything she did trying to get well. Here, try some ivy root, you know, a little honey and cinnamon. Who knows what they were giving?" But she knew she could just touch the hem of Jesus. Straight away, that woman was restored to health. I mean, if it happened then, it can happen now. Right? It's the same yesterday, today, forever. In Luke 17:12, it says, "And he entered into a certain village. There he met 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, 'Jesus, Master, have mercy on us.' And when he saw them, he said unto them, 'Go show yourself to the priests.' And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when they saw that he was healed," you think about it, I mean, the body parts were falling off, maybe they didn't have noses anymore, or ears, fingers, and all of a sudden they're being restored as they go. "And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned the air with a loud voice, glorified God, and he fell down at his feet, his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, 'Were there not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? There are not found that returned to give glory to God, save the stranger.' And he said unto him, 'Arise, go thy way, thy faith has made thee whole.'" Jesus helped, "Get up, get on your way. Your faith, your trust, your confidence springs from the belief of understanding who God is. Restored you to health." So, what is faith? It's not leaning, and we're going to not lean on our own understanding, right? If we're going to need faith, we're practice just trusting God. We don't have to understand how it all works. We just have to understand He's who we trust for it, right? It says in Proverbs 3:5, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not on thy own understanding." When you start to try to lean on your own understanding, how's this going to work? Then you end up like the naturalist guys that don't think, you know, miracles are real, or they happen today, or they don't understand it, right? I'm trying to overanalyze it. And he's not telling us to do that. He's saying, don't try to understand it all, just believe in Him, trust in Him, and all thy ways according to Him, and He shall direct your path. In Colossians 2:5, it says, "Without be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and steadfastness of your faith in Christ." So confidence and faith seem pretty much harmonious, they're synonymous, right? And oftentimes they can be interchanged without losing the context of what's being said here. So we've got all these scholarly types, all the intellectual types running around. We can come up with all sorts of big names and fancy definitions of what faith really is. I've come to this conclusion: faith is confidence in God. Simply what it is. I remember there's a story of this great theologian, and one of the students, there was a student assembly, one of the seminary students that are trying to, you know, show off his great intellect and said to the great professor, what's the most profound thought you've ever had? What's the most profound thought any of you have ever had? And I looked at the answer of the professor. He said, the erudite professor says, Jesus loved me this time, no, because the Bible tells me so. It's so incredibly profound. So faith and confidence in God. Faith is the act of knowing that if God says it, he's going to do something. And he's going to do it, whether you know it happens straight away or not. He said he's going to do it, then it's going to happen. And so we're not going to waver in our faith and cancel out our prayers. And James 1:6, you know, but let him ask in faith, not wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven through the wind and tossed. And let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man's unstable in all his ways. So we need to maintain an attitude of God's word says it, I believe it, I receive it, that settles it. Amen? So the world's way is that, you know, see something and then I'll believe it. Show us the sign, Jesus. We'll believe you if you just show us the sign. Matthew 12:39. But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonah. So through Christ our Lord, he's always ready, more than willing to hear, answer our prayers, our desires, provided we line up with his word. Clearly he's telling us here that those that ask amiss, that they ask because, you know, they didn't ask properly. The resurrection of Christ from the dead is his own divine power, right? He's referred here prophetically as a sign of the prophet Jonah. Because we've got great proof of Christ, you know, being the Messiah because of this. Being 3 days in the grave as Jonah was 3 days inside a whale's tummy. How extraordinary. So the Lord granted supernatural signs to those that desired them to confirm the faith. He did, for example, Abraham and Gideon. The Lord denied signs to those that demanded them simply because, you know, they wanted an excuse for their own belief. Well, you're not going to believe me anyways. Why should I do something for you? You're not going to believe it. It's like, think about it. They've got these cruel religious leaders that are watching the purity of all innocents suffer and die on the cross. In Matthew 27:42, he saved others. Himself he cannot save. If he be the king of Israel, let him now come down off the cross, then we'll believe him. How incredible. These guys are watching him suffer like that, and they make these comments in front of the cross. In other words, they sadly are conditioned, appropriate by demonic influences, you know, society, to only believe what they see. However, in the Lord's kingdom, it says that we're to believe first, and then we'll see results. Again, therefore I say unto you, what things shall you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you shall have them. Our friend Marlene Kleps was born a paraplegic, and she kept seeing and imagining, you know, herself completely healed. She spent most of her childhood being, you know, ostracized because none of the kids really wanted to play with her. So she missed out on all day for like 17, 18 years. And she kept imagining seeing herself riding a bicycle, running and playing, doing all the normal things people could do. And then one day it happened. A little church service. We prayed for her. She came out of a wheelchair completely healed. It's just incredible. Medically documented, so we might bring her in sometime to speak here. I'd love to do that. So keeping in mind, we've got unclean spirits, they can be cast out, they got to leave. But, you know, it says they go into torment, which is, I think, is very good, you know, arrangement. You come into peace, they go into torment. But it also says they can return if you're not filled up with the word of God. So, there shouldn't be any room in your holy temples for anybody except you and the Holy Spirit. That's the way it should be, right? So I say this to help explain that the physical manifestations that will come only after we believe, you know, not before we believe. We've got to believe this. Hebrews 11, verse 1 says, now faith is the substance, it's an actual substance, of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So faith is an assurance, it's confirmation, it's like a deed, the title deed, of things we hope for, being the proof of things we do not see exactly at the moment, but we've got conviction of the reality anyways. Perceiving the real fact that even though it's not revealed to the senses yet. So in Hebrews here in chapter 4, it says the Israelites, under the leadership of Moses and Aaron, didn't enter into the promised land because of what? They were out there entertaining spirits of doubt and unbelief and their disobedience. The same gospel was preached to them as preached to us. It says in Hebrews 4:2, for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. So here we see that under the leadership, even they had these wonderful, you know, Joshua and Caleb, they believed, they got into the promised land. But the rest of them were allowed in. And then we think about this, for even Jesus said he was not able to help the people in his hometown of Nazareth because they were entertaining spirits of doubt and unbelief. I reckon they didn't even come out to see him. Ah, it's just Jesus of Nazareth. Wow, we don't have to go out to see him. We saw him grow up here. It says in Mark 6:5, and there do no mighty works save that he healed, laid his hands on a few sick folk and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went around the village teaching. So he goes, I need to teach these people. I can't even get them healed yet until they understand this process. And then in Mark chapter 5, verse 36, Jesus went to raise a little girl from the dead. Remember that one? There's a lot of people in the house at this point getting ready to have a funeral. Jesus walks in and ruins a perfectly good funeral. He goes, she's just asleep. And they laugh at him, they scorn him. Ah, you're a crazy Nazareth guy. You know, what a crazy rabbi. They proceeded to chase all the people out. I suppose kind of the same way he got rid of, you know, turned over tables. I mean, he said, okay, you're out of here, right? Throws them out. And the power of God comes in, raises that dead girl. Obviously, all the things possible with the Lord. I mean, he didn't make you into a robot. He allowed you the freedom of choice, even if you cause trouble, and you get in the way at times. So if the Lord Jesus couldn't help people because of their unbelief, then as a minister of the gospel, I certainly can't help you either if you're filled up with spirits of doubt and unbelief. No matter how much faith I've got, perhaps that's the reason the Lord wants us to understand this. The Lord called his disciples to observe what he did, then go out and you do the same thing. Make more disciples than every preceding generation. What did they watch him do? They watched him preach the gospel. They watched him cast all demons and heal the sick. And that's what he said he wants you to do. Right? John 14:12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me the works that I do, he shall do also greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Now, if Jesus, think about it. Jesus healed and did creative cures because he was anointed by the Holy Ghost and stayed in a place like Acts 10:38. He's got every right to expect us to obey and do this as well. When the disciples of the Holy got baptized in the Holy Spirit, they were equipped to go into the harvest. Do the Great Commission to the ends of the earth. I mean, if he didn't do it this way, then how does he expect us to do anything? But he gave us the power to do this. And a lot of times we're not engaging in that. You can put yourself in this. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Well, isn't he with you? Then you can go and do good and heal all that are oppressed of the devil, for God is with you. So if you've got faith, then you mix your faith, my faith, and we join together, we trust the root of the hand of God, bless you in numerous ways. But if there's a spirit of doubt and unbelief, I'm probably going to have a more difficult time helping you get free. However, I've seen at times, you know, my faith, I've said to people that said, when you pray for you and you're now aware it won't work, and I go, my faith comes from unbelief. And I pray for them anyways, and I've had several cases where there was a lady that was needing knee surgery, she was a doctor's wife, and I said, can I pray for you? She said, I don't believe in anything that happened. And I go, my faith comes from unbelief, so I pray for her anyways. She can be able to testify the keys of the surgery. But hallelujah. Right? But, you know, we've all heard somebody say things like, maybe they weren't healed because they didn't have enough faith. We hear that too often in churches. What a line of rubbish. I mean, if it only takes a tiny mustard seed to get the job done, why would anybody say that? It's ridiculous. I've heard people say things like, someday when I have more faith, then I'll probably be more bold like you, and I'll go and pray for people in need. Seems to me true heartfelt repentance is what's primarily necessary as a prelude for healing to happen. Having some measure of faith, healing certainly seems to be a necessary ingredient. The repentance part's really vital to this understanding here. Now, Romans 12:3 tells each one of us has been given a measure of faith of God. We see in Matthew 17:20, Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you have the faith of a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove hence the yonder place, and it shall remove, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. And then we remember how this story, we have the man that brought his son that had epilepsy, that's what he's describing here, in Mark 9, verse 22. And oftentimes it is cast into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou cast anything and have compassion on us and help us, Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believe. And straightway the father of the child cries out and says in tears, and he's repenting now. He understands. He has a revelation. Lord, I believe. Help me in my unbelief. That's an incredible put faith to action, right? Okay, I admit it. I'm struggling here. I want to overcome. I want to be an overcomer, Lord. Help me in my unbelief. So you've got to believe what God says. Let it bless it, heal you, restore you. That man was honest. What an honest statement. He had an honesty about his weakness and faith in Jesus. And immediately he acted on that, and the Lord healed his son. He realized he had a part to play in that healing. You could always pray, Lord, increase my faith. Even though you've got a measure of faith, faith comes by hearing, right? The apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. Increase that trust, that confidence that springs from belief in God. You want me to increase like you have it. It's in Luke 17. The apostle said unto the Lord, increase our faith. The Lord said, if you have faith, and bring a mustard seed, you might save the sycamore tree, be thou plucked up by the root, be planted by the sea, in the sea, and it should obey you. See, we're living in unprecedented times. There appears to be a continual flow of reports happening all over the world. You've got lying signs and wonders coming in, occurring every day now. I think when, and not if, disclosure happens, when it happens, how many people in churches are going to fall away from faith because they weren't grounded in the Word to begin with? How many people are going to think the accounts of ETs and the abductions of people, especially children, they're conducting experiments, that's not acceptable behavior in any culture, in any world, right? As my friend Derek Gilbert so eloquently wrote to forward in my book, Unmasking the Future, he talks about, and asks the question, you know, why does the church of ET have more true believers than Jesus Christ? I think it's an excellent question today to be asked in churches. basically because the preachers of the ancient alien gospel, they're much more happy to listen without judgment. They're not going to judge you when you tell them strange stories, right? How many Christians instead of denying themselves, picking up the cross, following after Christ, they're so quick to judge others without having all the data, without having all the information. They just want to judge. Matthew 7 and verse 5 says, "Thou hypocrite, first cast off the beam with thine own eye, and then shalt thou see clearly to cast the mote of thy brother's eye." See, understanding this whole UFO phenomena, it's not about science and exploration, like with the whole thing with NASA and the Vatican's involvement with the astrobiology. Target wrote how the ufology offers the false answers to the big questions that haunt humanity. Where did we come from? Why are we here? What happens after we die? As true born again spiritual Christians, we have definitive answers. And instead of sharing the good news with people who may be in the greatest hour of need, we often make ourselves an obstacle between them and the gospel of Jesus. We've got the shadow governments. We've got Hollywood. We got the community, you know, painting this picture of how the extraterrestrials have traveled millions and millions of light years just to come and tell us that Jesus was wrong. Right? This is my opinion. It's part of the great coming deception. It's already here. It's unfolding before the church today. And how many churches won't even address it? Where is their faith? Well, you know, if we talk about strange things, we might lose some big tithers. Where is your faith? Who are you relying on? Man or God to provide? Galatians 1:8. "But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed." See, people pray for great faith, yet they don't always understand that faith continually grows by stepping out in everyday challenges. Doing something that might not fully understand or you have any experience with, but simply being led by the Holy Spirit. I mean, no one's born automatically, comes to the world as a person of great faith, do they? Doesn't faith become great through experiences? I mean, every time I pray for somebody who's seen a supernatural manifestation and a medically documented report that they've been healed, that increases my faith. So it's like no great artist, no great musician, no great intellectuals, no great scientists are automatically great at their calling and destiny when they're born, are they? They have to work at it. They develop their skills. They develop the techniques. Again, faith's like a muscle. It's only going to grow and use as you exercise it. When the disciples asked Jesus to increase their faith, he responded by encouraging them. All you need is faith that's as small as a mustard seed. It's a tiny. Have you ever seen mustard seed? It's like a little pinion. It's so tiny. It can grow really big trees. So again, we got to see this concept of sowing and reaping. If you have faith, you plant it by doing something in action based on your trust, based on your confidence in the power of God. And one way to release our faith is by doing something God asks us to do. Faith requires us to take action. It's a choice, just as we have freedom of thought. So the council of the disciples in Luke 17, they weren't doing very much at the time in the situation, and they wanted great faith. So there's times that God wants us to wait on him before we take any action, just being sensitive to the leading of the Holy Spirit. But again, trust is, you know, it's active, it's not passive. So the more you step out and you know, the Lord just, you know, talk to that person about me. Share Christ's love with somebody, right? And just be bold and do it. It's amazing to me how many Christians seem hindered by just stepping out and go, hey, you know, Jesus really loves you. He wants you bigger. Just start a conversation about the Lord. I don't think anybody's able to talk to me for a couple of minutes without the Lord presence coming into the conversation. Praise God for that. Now, my friend Dr. Terry gave me a word picture years ago. That when you pull a weed out of the ground, it stays green, it pretends it's still, you know, happening, still vibrant, but it's got no root system, it can't survive, right? So when you cast out an evil spirit, it's kind of the same thing, it's pretending it's still got some legal right. It doesn't, you've cancelled the legal right. So at times these demonic presence manifests after a healing's happened, the healed person becomes disillusioned because they're aware of a symptom by a former illness that they had that they were healed of, and now that the battle in mind begins. Don't believe it. Don't agree with it. Speak the word of God out instead, you know. Thank you, Lord, by the stripes of Jesus, I'm healed. Submit yourself, therefore, God. Resist the devil and he will flee. These are what we need to do with those times. When symptoms or diseases or problems or addictions try to come back, you need to stop it and apply the principles of you learn to be healed the first time, and the symptoms will go. Step out in faith. See, faith works by love. I think that's the thing, that's the most important thing we can say here is when we receive healing, power, you know, restoration, blessings, it works by love. Galatians 5:5 says, for we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith, for in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything nor uncircumcision, but faith worketh by love. So faith works by love. Love can be defined as devotion. Parents normally would have a very deep affection. Babies fill parents with this intense feeling of love. People get that with pets as well. It's a strong affection, lots of definitions for it, but to me the main things here are move the hand of God. Move in the hand of God is simply prayer, engaging in inner conversation with the Lord. Fasting is good, and worshiping the Lord. You get a place of worship, miraculous things can happen. Amen? So if you want that mountain move in faith to happen, yes, bless you. So we gotta share Christ's love. We gotta walk in Christ's love. We gotta be outrageous and radical in His love. And the opposite's all true. If you operate in the fullness of Christ's love, if you're not doing that, how's your faith gonna increase and operate? In 1 Corinthians 13, it's basically the chapter we talk about love. What love is this that, you know, that he provided for us the way he has? So you can't afford to live in any kind of strife. And confessions are good, and I encourage you, but if you stop and find out, you know, where you can love more, and begin to see your faith work more. Remember, it all starts in your mind. And so you don't meditate on negative things. About anything that would hinder your relationship with the Lord. So I think this is really vital for us to understand that we just carry on and we can talk about why people aren't healed, but it still comes down to trusting God and believing Him. If you love God, you keep His commandments and you won't have any troubles to begin with. So. This is really the bottom line for it. So again, I go back to Romans 12:2, be not conformed to the way this world works. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, prove what is good, acceptable, the perfect will of God. Amen?
Yeah.
So let us pray. We just thank you for God for this time. Thank you for your word. Thank you for restoration. Thank you for healing virtue to be released. We thank you, Father God, for even healing this nation. That you allow your servants to perform supernatural healing miracles in your almighty name. That many will come to you as an outpouring in these last days. We may receive salvation. So save us, Lord. Save our families. Save our friends. We pray for our enemies. Those that spitefully abuse us. Those that have persecuted us. those that serve the devil in his fallen kingdom. Save us from those leaders that are willing to engage in nuclear wars, that would rather blow up the planet than give up their power positions. We just thank you, Father God, you protect us from all their chants, all the seances, all the witchcraft, all the warlocks, and all the things that they embrace in error because they don't know you. All the Freemasonry and Illuminati things that they're into. We pray for our enemies, Lord. We pray for the enemies of the church. We pray for the enemies against your word. I pray you would wake up your sleeping church. Wake up the church, Lord. Enable them to do what you've instructed us to do. That we overcome these iniquities and generational, transgenerational epigenetics. That you heal us personally. Heal and restore our broken hearts, Lord. You came to heal broken hearts. You came to restore broken marriages, to heal broken children and broken adults. Heal our churches, Lord. Save us from those that preach another gospel, all the smooth-talking, secret-friendly messages on grace and steroids, Lord. Speak to your true ministers that preach fearlessly the whole gospel, that you move in signs and wonders and healings and miracles, that follow them, that will follow after you. I thank you for just bringing us political leaders that surrender completely to you with all their heart. Heal the nation, Lord, from all the filth and deception of the entertainment industry. My God, my King, let your salvation spread from sea to sea in every nation on earth, from the rising of the sun to the setting of the sun. Let the earth be filled with the knowledge of your glory, the eternal living Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Messiah Shore. Lord God, we pray for this planet. We pray that your Holy Spirit move in our midst. Convict us of sins. Deliver us from the evil. That you might heal the land, Lord, and spare us from the coming great deceptions, all the Nephilim agendas, and all the lying signs and wonders, and all the works of darkness. We thank you, Father God, for waking up your church to the truth. They open their eyes and see the reality of who you are. That we're able to submit to you and resist the devil, and the devil would flee because he's been so incredibly frightened by your people, walking in your power, in your might, in your victory, that we're overcomers. Lord, I pray you bring back the lost ones to your fold because of your mercy endureth forever. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Thank you, faithful God. Thank you, Lord, that you hear our prayer. Send your Holy Spirit to overtake us with the blessings of Abraham. And we thank you, Lord. We give you all the praise. We give you all the thanksgiving. We give you all the worship, all the glory. We thank you for supernatural peace and healing and provision, for your divine protection to cover us always with oceans of agape love. Thank you, Lord. Just cover us in the blood of Jesus, Yeshua. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah and amen. I pray, Lord, too, for blind eyes to open, deaf ears to hear, the lame to get up and walk. Diseases would just simply disappear on people because they come into alignment with your word. Every molecule in the body will come back into alignment. Whatever they're suffering with, Lord, restore them, Lord. Praise you, Father God. Praise you, Lord. We just worship you. Praise you, God. In the almighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
God's word concerning his purpose and plans for money, concluded that it's best used in line with his will, ultimately to give his glory, to give him glory, because all things that were created were created for that purpose. So last week we began to look at the biblical disciplines shown to us involving money. so that we can understand how best to be in agreement with God's word and fall under his blessing. And that first discipline that we looked at was contentment. And we recognized from that we first had to be saved. We need to make Jesus Lord, and that we needed to surrender to him. And that our goal and sights are to be on eternity and not money. Money's not our God. Jesus is to mean everything to us. So we indicated that once God has the commitment of our hearts, then he can begin to change our mind and our thinking about money. And we understand that contentment in Christ, that is what true wealth is. Then the result of contentment in Christ is that we'll spend less and less on ourselves and our desires as we seek to give more and more to others and fulfill God's desires. Well, today we're going to look at the first part of the second discipline in God's providential plan on money, which is about diligent work. And then next week we'll look at the second part, which is good stewardship. So we have to begin talking about diligent work by understanding that it's God's will that we do work. And we see the first instance of God creating work for man, that being Adam, in God's word in Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. And there it reads, "And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and keep it." So we learn from this scripture that Adam had a job to do assigned to him by God. He was the first master gardener. And I'm sure he learned an awful lot from the Lord. Additionally, we need to work to meet our own needs, and we see two references to this, one in the Old Testament, one in the New Testament. In Old Testament Proverbs chapter 28, verses 19, we read, "He that tilleth his land shall have plenty of bread, but he that followeth after vain persons shall have poverty enough." And then in the New Testament, 2 Thessalonians 3:10, "For even when we were with you, this was commanded you, that if any would not work, neither should he eat." So previously we learned that contentment in Christ helps us to spend less on ourselves. And understanding God's call to work diligently, helps us to earn more money. And hopefully a gap will develop between our spending and our income as our income grows. And as that gap grows, we need to learn to manage the excess wisely. We need to learn how to prosper. And we need to learn how to give generously to the needs of others. We can use the abundance that God, that comes from diligent work to meet our needs and to help meet the needs of others. Also regarding diligent work, the attitude and spirit we have as we approach our work can also glorify and honor God's name. And Paul exhorted this, his fellow Christians, to work precisely for these reasons. In Ephesians 4:28, we read, "Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands the thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth." And we also see the example of Paul himself relating to diligent work by meeting his own needs while he was serving among the brothers. Acts chapter 20, verses 34 and 35 says, "Yea, ye yourselves know that these hands have ministered unto my necessities and to them that were with me. I have showed you all things, how that so laboring ye ought to support the weak and to remember the words of the Lord Jesus, how he said, it is more blessed to give than to receive." Now, in addition, looking at the perspective from the opposite direction of not working, the Bible warns against the dangers of laziness because it brings poverty, dishonor, and difficulties in life. And God wants to protect us from these things and these dangers, and that's part of the reason he calls us to work hard. So let's examine ourselves here and ask the questions. What's our own view of work, and what's our attitude about work? We find ourselves in line with what God wills for our lives there? Are we bitter and angry at God that he requires us to work? Do we honor God in our work and show the love of God to others in our job? What's our own testimony regarding work? What would someone close to you at work say about your work ethic and your attitude? Recognize that probably for most people, about 80% of their awake hours are spent dealing with their finances in some way or another. So today we give back part of what we've earned from working. We're saying that we are willing to give to God's church to support it, our pastor and its mission. And certainly God's church is intended to bring glory to Him. So our giving as members of His church does honor Him and follows His will. So let's pray today as we give as the Spirit leads us to do so. Father, we just come before You. And Father, we do seek to be diligent workers who do all for Your glory, who seek to honor You. Father, we are also thankful for You giving us opportunity to work. And when we don't have jobs, we pray, Lord, that You would find us the right job. You would put us in the right place where we can use our talents that You've given us and where we can be helpful to others and where we can glorify You. So, Father, we give today because You've given to us. You've provided for us, and Lord, we give to Your church, Lord, that Your will would be done through it. In Jesus' name.